In this video, we'll talk about the computer system. So before talking about computer system, first of all, let's see what is a computer. So a computer is an electronic device that can be programmed, to accept data, that is called your input, process it, and generate results, that is your output. So this is what a computer is used for. It is used to feed the data, that's your input, then process the data and generate output. Now a computer along with the hardware and software together is called your computer system or a computing system. So whenever you just consider the computer hardware and software together, that is called your computer system. So a computer system primarily consists of the CPU, that is your central processing unit. Then we have memory, where we store data and instructions for the CPU. Then we have input or output devices, that is your keyboard, mouse, joystick, microphone. These are your input devices. Then in output devices we have monitor, printers, etc. And then at last we have storage devices, where we store data permanently, right? Now if you talk about this central processing unit, that is a CPU, it is the electronic circuitry of a computer that carries out the actual processing. So your CPU is given instructions and data through programs. So whatever data and instructions are present in the memory, that is fetched by CPU for further processing. So what basically your CPU does is, it fetches the program and data from the memory and performs arithmetic and logical operations as per the given instructions, and then it stores the result back to the memory, right? So your CPU consists of your registers, the small memory devices which can hold a very limited amount of data inside itself. Then it has arithmetic and logical unit which can perform arithmetic and logical calculations, and then it has control unit which controls the flow of data throughout the entire computing system. Next, if you talk about this input devices, these are the devices which are used for feeding the data in a computer, and output devices are used for obtaining the information that is generated by a computer, right? So there are plenty of examples of input and output devices, which is needless to say here, right? Now if you talk about this memory, computer memory, so it is used for storing data and instructions. Your memory is used for storing data and instructions for processing. So now if you consider the types of memory, we have basically three types, that is your primary memory, cache memory, and secondary memory. We'll talk about this. So before getting into the types of memory, let's talk about the units of memory. Just like how you measure length, mass, time, these physical quantities, similarly there is a unit for measuring memory in computer system. So a computer system uses binary numbers actually to store data, right? Your computer understands only binary data, right? That means the collection of binary data, that is a bits, is the only language that is understood by a computer. So the smallest unit of a computer, or a smallest entity that a computer can understand, is your bit. A bit can be 1 or 0. In electrical language, if you talk about off or on signal, right? That's your bit. So this word bit has originated from the word binary digit. So binary digit in short is called bit. So when we consider collection of bits together, then we have allocated different names to that. Like when you combine 8 bits together, it is called your 1 byte. When you combine 1024 bytes together, that's called your 1 kilobyte. When you combine 1024 kilobytes together, that is your 1 megabyte. Next, when you combine 1024 megabytes, that's called your 1 gigabyte. Then, when you combine 1024 gigabytes together, that's called your 1 terabyte. Then, if you combine 1024 terabyte, then it is called your 1 petabyte. And the list goes on like that. Now, if you talk about the types of memory, so there are basically three types of memory, as I told you earlier, right? That's your primary memory, cache memory, and secondary memory. So if we talk about this primary memory, it is the essential component of a computer system. The programs and data are loaded into the primary memory before processing it. So under this primary memory, we have two types. One is your random access memory, that is your RAM, random access memory, and then we have ROM, that is your read-only memory. So RAM is volatile in nature, that means as long as the power is supplied to the computer, it retains the data in it. But whereas your ROM is non-volatile in nature, that means the content of the ROM are not lost even when the power is turned off. So that is it. So basically your ROM contains the startup program, that is your bootloader, that loads the operating system into the primary memory. That means when your computer has to start the operating system, that information is present in the ROM. And your RAM is basically used for storing data and instructions that are to be used by the CPU, that's your microprocessor, right? So once you turn off the power supply, whatever data was present in RAM is completely washed away, right? Then next we have is something called cache memory. Now the question is, what is the need of this cache memory? So RAM is actually faster than secondary storage, but it is not as fast as the computer processor, right? So because of RAM, the CPU might have to slow down. So in order to avoid this slowdown, we have this intermediate memory called cache memory. So in order to speed up the operations of the CPU, this very high speed memory, that is your cache memory, is placed between, it just bridges the speed gap between the CPU and the RAM. So you might have heard 3MB, 4MB cache memory is very common nowadays. Even 8MB, 12MB cache is also provided with many commercial microprocessors, right? So I hope this much discussion is enough for this RAM, ROM and cache memory. Next we come to our secondary memory. So primary memory has actually limited storage, and second thing is that the data that is stored in primary memory is volatile in nature. That means once the power supply is off, whatever data was present in this primary memory is completely erased off. I'm talking about this RAM. Basically, whenever I say the word memory here in this course, so I'll be referring to RAM unless and until I explicitly state the word, right? Now, secondary memory is actually limited in nature. So, and the primary memory is limited in nature in the computer system, and because the data that is present in the primary memory is your volatile in nature, right? So we cannot rely on that. So in order to store the data permanently, we use something called secondary memory. So under secondary memory, we have hard drive, solid state drive, floppy disk that was used back then, right? Nowadays we don't use floppy drives because of its limited storage capacity. Then we have hybrid drives, right? SSDs are very famous nowadays because they are quite faster as compared to your mechanical drives, and so on. Now if we talk about the data transfer, so whenever CPU, so actually the need of data transfer is important in order to communicate through all the components that are present in the computing system. So data are transferred between different components of a computer system using some set of physical wires called bus. So what is bus? Set of physical set of physical wires through which the data is transferred in between the different components of a computer system. Now there are three types of buses. First is your data bus. So data bus is responsible for transferring data between the different different components in the computing system. Then next is your address bus. So it is used to transfer addresses between CPU and the main memory. So the address of the memory location, actually the memory is chunked into various addresses. Like your house, you have address. Similarly, a memory is divided into various chunks and each chunk has been assigned an address. So this address is actually used for storing data, and this address is only travels through this address bus actually to perform read or write operation, right? The next one we have control bus. So control bus is used to communicate control signals between the different components of a computing system. Anyways, you don't need to know too much, you don't need to have too much deep knowledge about this bus. When you will study the subject of computer organization and architecture, then you will study about this bus in more details. So as of now, this much knowledge is sufficient. Now if you talk about this CPU actually, so the other name of this CPU is also microprocessor. So in earlier days, the CPU was very limited in nature. I mean to say that the capacity of a CPU used to be very limited, but with the advancement of technology, the physical size of the CPU has reduced day by day and the power of a CPU has increased significantly in modern days computers. So there are some important terms related to this CPU, so we'll focus on those terms. First thing is word size. What is the meaning of this word size? It is the maximum number of bits that a microprocessor can read at a time. So earlier your microprocessors, like in back then at that time, 8 bits, your microprocessors were capable of reading 8 bits at a time. But nowadays the processors are powerful enough to read 64 bits at a time, right? So you can just see the jump. So more the capacity of word size, more the word size, the better is the processor, right? Next is memory size. Now what is this memory size? So depending upon the word size, the size of RAM varies. So initially RAM was very small, it used to be very small, in megabytes it used to come, 4 to 8 bits a word it could read, right? For your 4 to 8 bits word size of microprocessor, there used to be very limited amount of RAM, like 4 MB or 8 MB of RAM. But as in today's day, your word size has increased to 64 bits, it has even become possible nowadays of having RAM up to sizes of 16 exabytes. So you can understand that how fast the technology has grown. Next point is your clock speed. So what is the meaning of this clock speed? So computers have an internal clock actually that generates pulses at regular intervals of time. So what is the meaning of this clock speed? It means the number of pulses that is generated per second by the clock that is present inside the computer. So actually we measure the frequency as by this formula, right? 1 by time period, if you know. 1 by time period is defined as the frequency. So earlier your old processors used to have frequency in megahertz, but with the growth of technology, nowadays we have microprocessor which can perform billions of instructions per second. We have gigahertz, we have processor which can work at the speed of gigahertz nowadays, right? That is billions of pulses it can generate per second. The next important point related to microprocessor is core. So what is core? A core is a basic computation unit of the CPU. So more the number of core, better is the performance of the CPU, right? So there is one more important term that is called your microcontrollers. So the microcontroller is a small computing device which has a CPU, a fixed amount of RAM, ROM and other peripherals that are embedded on a single chip, that is a system on chip, that is your SoC. So these microcontrollers are basically used in keyboard, mouse, washing machine, digital cameras, pen drives, etc. So these are some of the examples. So these are designed for specific task only. That means to a very targeted kind of task your microcontrollers can perform. So because of very small size of the microcontroller, it is embedded in other devices to perform a specific functionality, right? Like your washing machine is intelligent enough when to turn it off, when to turn it on, how much water to supply, how much detergent must be supplied. All these are controlled via this microcontrollers. Now the next important terminology that I want to talk about is data and information. So what is data? Data is nothing but the collection of raw facts and figures. That is your data. And whatever processed data you have, whatever data you obtain after processing it, that is called your information. So in short, we can say the collection of raw facts and figure is your data, and the data that is obtained after processing the raw facts and figure, that is your information. So it can be pictures, songs, videos, documents. But you should remember one thing: a computer stores data end of the day in binary digits, that is your bits. So we have different types of data, that is your structured data, unstructured data, semi-structured data. You can study about these things in more detail in Google or Wikipedia, right? Now whenever we have data, what all things we can do with the data? First thing is we can capture the data. So like you use your digital camera to capture the images, right? And then we store it in our storage devices like your pen drives, SSDs, okay, all these devices we store the data. And finally we are also interested in retrieval. We also want to retrieve the data, because whatever data you store, you wanna just refresh it again, or you want to fetch the data for using it for some other purpose. Like let's say once you capture the data, you store it in your permanent storage devices, and if you need to touch up your photographs, whatever you have clicked in some photo editing software like Adobe Photoshop, so in that case you are also interested in retrieving that data. Along with this, whenever we have too much unnecessary or unwanted amount of data, we also need to erase it. So the process of erasing the data, unwanted data, that is called your deletion. And sometimes what happens, accidentally the data gets corrupted or it gets deleted. So in that case we are also performing data recovery on that particular data which you have lost accidentally, right? Now talking enough, I have talked enough based on this data and information. Let's focus on something called software. So what is a software? So this provides the basic functionality to operate a computer, right? Now there are various types of software. So actually software is very important. You know, if you want to use the computer hardware, you need the software, because end of the day your computer system is incomplete without software. We need both hardware and software together to so that the entire computer system can survive. Yes or no? Now so we can understand that software is very important. So a software actually knows how to use different hardware components of the computer system to make it work, right? Now we have three categories of software. So first is your system software, then next we have your application software, and the last thing is your programming tools. So these programming tools are actually used for building the or for developing the software. Now if I talk about this system software briefly, so it is the software which directly interacts on the hardware. So operating system is such an example. So you have various operating system like Windows, Linux. Linux is actually not an operating system, it's a kernel. Your Ubuntu is an operating system, you can say, right? Linux is kernel. Then we have Mac OS, which is installed in the Apple devices, right? So these were some of the examples of operating system. Then we have system utilities like your disk defragmenters for defragmenting your disk, okay, files in the disk. And then we have device drivers. So device drivers are the system softwares where the information is present, how to use, or for the smooth functioning of the particular device, we use device drivers. Like your whenever you purchase a new printer, with that they provide the device driver so that you can install it in your operating system and can use the device smoothly, right? The next category is your application software. So these application software runs on top of the system software. So this provides the core functionality of the computer system. So there are various categories under this also, like we have general purpose software, then and the next category is your customized software. So under your general purpose software, we have word processing software, image editing software, web browsers, etc. And then next we have customized software. We'll talk about this customized software in more detail in some other kind of video. And then lastly we have programming tools. So this consists of your compilers, assemblers, linkers, loaders, programming languages. So which we'll talk about these tools in the later videos. So basically these are the three categories of software that is available. So the most important system software that we need is the operating system. So it is considered as the resource manager, which manages all the resources of the computing system. So there are various services that are provided by the operating system, like process management, etc. There is a entire subject in itself, operating system, which is taught at undergraduate and graduate level. So this much discussion is enough for us to get started with programming. So what did we learn from beginning? If you just revise, we have learnt about the computer, the basic definition. We saw that what a computer system consists of. We saw the devices that a computer system is consisting of. We studied about units of memory, types of memory, bus, word size, the basic terminologies that are related to a microprocessor. Then we also discussed about data and information. Then what all things we do with data. We capture it, store it, and then retrieve it as and when required. Then data deletion, recovery, software. So this much detail is enough to get started with programming. So in the next video, I'll be talking about some other topics. So till that, stay tuned with us.